What are these huge birds that visit Virginia each winter? And why are they so important? Where do these birds go when they leave Virginia in the spring? Let's join the students from Hunt-Mapp School in Portsmouth and meet the students from Kaktovic School in Kaktovic, Alaska, as we take a look outside at Virginia's biggest bird, the Tundra Swan.
My name is Ryan and I'm in the seventh grade.
My name is Dominique, I'm in the seventh grade.
My name is Stephanie, I'm in the seventh grade.
My name is Johnny and I'm in the seventh grade.
My name is George, I'm in the seventh grade.
My name is Precious and I'm in the seventh grade.
And I'm Miss Roberts, I'm their teacher here at Hunt-Mapp Middle School for Life Science.
Good morning. As your teacher told you, I work for the Virginia Department of Game and Inland Fisheries, and I work mostly with migratory birds.
Gary Costanzo knows all about tundra swans and has come to share his knowledge with Mrs. Roberts' life science class.
And this happens to be a tundra swan, and I'm going to talk to you today about tundra swans because you guys are involved with a class from Alaska, or you're going to be involved in communicating with a class from Alaska and talking about swans and swan migrations, because some of the swans that we have that winter here in the state of Virginia actually fly all the way to Alaska to nest and to raise their young in the summertime. And they actually fly back to Virginia in the wintertime. So you guys are going to be involved in a class project. And in addition to that, we're going to take you out to one of our wildlife management areas, our Hog Island Wildlife Management Area, where we're actually going to catch some birds. You're going to watch us and help us catch some of these birds so we can actually mark them with some of these radio transmitters that we use to follow their movements. And we're going to follow them from Virginia all the way across the country up to the tundra, the Arctic tundra, and back again. Okay, so let's talk about swans. The first thing you see, what impresses you about swans? They're big birds, aren't they? I mean, they're really big. In waterfowl, they're kind of three different groups of birds. There's the ducks, which are pretty small. There's geese, which are bigger. And then there's the swans, which are the biggest. So these guys are pretty impressive birds. They can weigh up to 20 pounds, and their wingspan can be over 6 feet. So they can spread their wings wider than I can spread my arms. Does this swan have any ears? Can he hear? Can swear? He can't, well, where's his ears? Underneath the feathers, right. He doesn't have ears like we do, external ears, but he's got ears on the side of his head just like we do. He's got an ear canal. It's just hidden under the feathers, and they actually have real good hearing. And they have real good vision, too.
Enough classroom instruction. Now it's time to study some real live birds.
Okay, we're going to go to our Hog Island Wildlife Management Area now. We've got some students that are going to come watch us and help us trap and catch some swans. We're going to look at the swans and we're going to put bands on the swans. So now's the time. Let's go. Time to go catch some swans.
In order to study the tundra swan, first you must catch a few. The birds are wary and hard to catch. The wildlife workers use corn to lure the swans to an area where they're setting up a rocket-propelled net. The net must be set up just right so as not to injure the birds. Biologists make a final check of their rocket nets. They retreat to their blinds for the long wait until the birds get to just the right place.
Take the birds.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
A success. Now we need to get to the birds quick before they hurt themselves. The swans are put in burlap bags, and none of the birds are injured. Being in the bags calms them down. Now the students begin their hands-on adventure with the tundra swan.
Not afraid of them, are they? I'll tell you a couple things about them. They're pretty big birds, aren't they? And they're very strong. But in fact, when you have them in your hands, they're pretty docile. See how everyone's just holding them? They're not trying to bite us or claw us or beat us with their wings or anything. They're really pretty docile.
Does anybody know what migration is?
I do.
What is migration?
It's when animals travel to like a nested spot and then come back. Like, that's what I think.
These are urban students. They have a lot of experience in the concrete streets of the city, but not much experience in the multiple wildlife areas of Virginia. They don't frequently get out there, and so an opportunity to be in one of our wildlife areas and to interact with the animals and here is an awesome experience for them.
See, they have very sharp claws. They don't try to claw you, but they just hook it sort of accidentally. Hey, you want to feel their claw? It's sharp. It won't hurt you. But for them to walk in the mud and on a hard, frozen ground, they need to be able to get some traction, some grip, right?
So what do these big birds eat?
What do they eat?
Like small fish? What kind of food? You think they're eating fish?
Or seaweed? Remember what I said before about their bill? They don't have any teeth, right?
Yeah.
But they have like little clippers.
Like seaweed.
Seaweed or seagrasses, yeah. Wetland vegetation, and even grass. They'll eat this green grass. They actually tip up to feed, and so they have to stick their head under the water to feed. So they have to hold their breath. Now there are some birds that actually can dive underneath the water, and they'll disappear. You won't see them because they'll be underneath. But these guys are too big to dive. What they do is they tip up, right? Their necks go down and their tails come up. You see the little tails bobbing in the water. And since they have such long necks, they can feed in pretty deep water. They've got a lot of neck bones. We call them vertebrae. They've got a lot more than you and I. That's why their neck is so long. And that's another adaptation that allows them to feed in water.
The swans are weighed and bands are put on their legs. These bands will identify the birds if they're ever caught again. Now it's time to send them on the first leg of their long migration flight. Some are a little reluctant to leave, and you can't blame them. From here, they must fly 3,000 miles to their summer home. Finally, they're on their way, and like jumbo jets, they need a long runway. This is where their 6-foot wingspan comes in handy. From the wetlands of Virginia's Hog Island, across the Great Lakes, and over western Canada, the birds make long flights each night until they reach northern Alaska, 3,000 miles away. Here on an isolated island off the coast of Alaska, teacher Deborah McAllister gives us a tour of the village of Kaktovic.
And it is 7:30, April 14th, and our sun is nice and high. Our first spring day.
This is where some of our Virginia swans will spend the summer raising their young. Scientists believe that the swans migrate to this harsh wilderness because there are far fewer predators here than in Virginia. Animals that would eat swan eggs, like raccoons, red foxes, and snakes, are not found in the far north of Alaska.
There's one of my students, there's Nika, getting her bite fixed. There's one of our elders. There's our school.
Hi, my name is Peter Taugig, I'm in the 6th grade.
Hi, my name is Tunika, I'm in the 6th grade.
In their warm classroom, the Kaktovic kids are using their computer lab to share information about tundra swans with Mrs. Roberts' class. 3,000 miles away, back in Portsmouth, Virginia, the kids are eagerly exchanging emails.
Hi, my name is Chelsea Miss Wood, and I am a 7th grader in Mrs. Roberts' science class. Do you have friends that eat swans also? What do they taste like? Are they full of meat? Down in Virginia, we don't eat swans very often because we don't see them very often.
Hi, my name is Precious Moore, and I'm in the 7th grade at Hunt-Mapp Middle School.
And my name is Ronette Hurt, and I'm also in the 7th grade here at Hunt-Mapp Middle School. Our teacher's name is Ms. Roberts.
Some of the students and our class went on a trip to Hog Island about tundra swans.
We helped catch some of the swans at Hog Island and also got the opportunity to hold them.
They were very heavy and had soft feathers.
Both the kids in Portsmouth and Kaktovic use their computers to follow the progress of swans being tracked by the Department of Game and Inland Fisheries. Swan Tracks, on the department's website, lets the class see each year's migration path in detail. Much is being learned from the birds that have been trapped, fitted with transmitters, and released.
These swans are beginning to start their migration back. Radio tracking has shown us that they don't go all the way in one fell swoop. They make their way up to the Great Lakes. They'll spend a couple days resting up, and then they continue on, and they'll end up in the Arctic Circle where they nest this summer.
As October approaches and temperatures begin to drop below zero, the swans complete their migration by leaving Alaska and returning to Virginia's warmer climate to spend the winter.
Very good. Very good. You've done that before.
What's that? Mrs. Roberts' class has also completed a journey from the city lights of Portsmouth to the wilds of Hog Island, the winter home of the tundra swan.
I learned that swans live in marshy habitats where they have lots of grass and other aquatic plants to eat.
My name is Barnett. I'm in the 7th grade, and I learned that they can migrate 3 to 5,000 miles at night.
My name is Precious, and I'm in the 7th grade, and I like the part where we got to hold the swans and the part where we got to email the people in Alaska where the swans spent the summer.
My name is Stephanie. I'm in the 7th grade. I like that when we weighed them, they weighed about 20 pounds.
My name is Dominique. I'm in the 7th grade. And I like when the swans were like taking off and like they were running across the water.
It's important for students to have real life experiences to draw from when we're talking about things like migration or habitats, those things in the classroom. And so bringing them out here where they can touch the swans and they can learn from wildlife biologists and they can be in the environment makes their learning so much authentic, so much more real.
I mean, we've been on a lot of different waterfowl capture operations, but I think it was made much more enjoyable just the fact that these youngsters got to see a tundra swan up close and personal. They got to hold the tundra swan. They got to assist, and they learned all about the data collection. I think it was just fantastic. Instead of seeing something from a distance, they got to be up close and participate, and it was just really fantastic to have them here with us.
I like the part where we had the where we got out of school early. We got to hold the swans. I thought that was fun. And the part I liked the most was when we got to let them go.
So we just go down there towards the...
Yeah, I know. I'm waiting for
you. You said how exciting.
That was great. Wonderful.
I think it's wonderful. I can't believe how docile they are and how gentle they are. Look warm. Think Bahamas. We're in the Bahamas.
You just have to squat.
Who can do that? Do that say hoo hoo. Say hoo hoo. Relax. Did you hear that one?
Did they answer you?
Well, I don't know if he answered me, but I heard one of them.